Well, good morning and welcome to Londonderry Christian Church, where we're here to love one more. We're so glad you've chosen to join us this morning, whether here in person in the building or if you're watching online. We're so glad that you've chosen to worship our great God with us. If this is your first time checking us out, we please encourage you to fill out our online Connect card. So if you're watching from home, you can click on the link in the Facebook comments. Or if you're here with us, you can go to LondonderryChristianChurch.com and click on Connect, and I'll take you to the Connect card. For everyone that fills out the Connect card, we're going to donate $5 to Restoration House Ministries. It's a ministry that starts new churches in New England, and so we really love to give some money away to them, so please fill out that Connect card so we can do so. There are a few things that are happening that we want to invite you to. The first one is to join us on Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. for prayer on Facebook, so join us for that. Also, we're starting a couple online Bible studies that are going to take place on Mondays at noon and Fridays at noon. Monday, we're going to start going through Core 52. So if you started on Core 52 and got behind, it's a way that we're going to catch up on Core 52. Then on Fridays, we're going to do 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. So you can sign up for those at LondonderryChristianChurch.com and click events and sign up for those Bible studies that will be online through Zoom on Friday and Mondays at noon. So sign up for that. Then also please join us for Serve Saturday on Saturday, October 24th, where we encourage you to go out and to serve in your neighborhood. Go help a neighbor rake their leaves, wash their windows, go pick up trash along your road. Find a way to serve where God has placed you, where you live. So as we get together today, in a few moments, we're going to sing some songs together. Then we're going to dig into God's Word and study together. And then later in our service, we're going to have a time to remember what Jesus has done for us in the act, or through the act of communion. And so if you're watching online, I encourage you to go ahead and go and grab a piece of bread or a cracker or a tortilla, some water, milk, or juice, and hold that for later so you can use that to celebrate what Christ has done for us. Today we're continuing our series called Keeping Your Faith in a World Gone Mad as we explore the book of Daniel. If you would, please say our verse of the day with me. Do not be afraid, you who were highly esteemed, he said. Peace, be strong now, be strong. When he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, speak, my Lord, since you've given me strength. Daniel chapter 10, verse 19. Let's pray. Father, may your spirit be at work in us today as we gather together around your Son and your Word. Help us to keep listening to you as we gather around the person of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Dave. In church, I'd like to invite you to stand, whether you're here or tuning in at home. I invite you to stand and worship with us.
Christ the glorious one, Christ the Father's son, Christ the glory.
for a place where we can come to worship you together, where we can learn from you and take everything that we hear this morning outside of these walls, that we might be your church outside, and that we might love one more through that. Father, we love you, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Thank you, church. It's us.
As we dive in today, again, I'm going to take a few moments to start by talking to our kids who are watching from home. Recently, or in the last year or so, I learned a secret that I want to share with you. So somebody told me that if you are with other people, like say you're with a bunch of other kids, and they're all being loud, and they're talking a lot, and you have something you want to say, we have a choice on how to get their attention. Kind of what I would normally do would be I try to be louder than they were. And that didn't work so well. So the secret I was told was, if you want to tell someone something and things are loud and they're all talking, rather than try to shout or be louder, instead, talk in a whisper. And the first time you do it, they may not pay attention, but keep speaking in a low, small whisper, and eventually, they will quiet down because they will decide that they need to be quiet to hear what you're trying to say. And I put this into practice. I've tried it with my kids. And they gather loud, and I want to be like, ah! Instead, I go, now, boys, you need to listen. I have something to tell you. And at first, they're letting it keep me loud, but then they'll quiet down, and they'll hear what I want to say to them. Now, sometimes being louder isn't how we get people to listen. And we see this even in the Bible. There's a story in the Bible where there's a guy named Elijah. He's a prophet. And Elijah's up on a mountain, and he wants God to talk to him, to tell him what he needs to know. And it says God comes and appears to Elijah. There's this great wind, and there's this fire and an earthquake. And the Bible says God was in none of that noise. What came after was a small, gentle whisper. And God was in the whisper. That God wants us to understand, like Elijah, that we need to be quiet and listen so we can hear him. But we need to pay attention to what he's saying. That we need to listen and try to hear what God is saying. And God is speaking to us. We believe that he's trying to teach us. And so we need to be ready to listen to his quiet whisper so we can know what he's saying. Thanks for joining me, guys. Thanks for listening. As we continue to dive in, when I was a kid growing up, my home church where I grew up supported a local Christian camp. And so there's a camp not far from us that had programs for kids. And I remember from as far back as I can remember, going to camp every summer and participating in the stuff. I remember starting out as a little kid, going to day camp, where you'd spend the day in camp and you get to have all kinds of fun. And then eventually I remember going to First Chance Camp, where you got to stay for like two nights at camp. I got to sleep over. Then as I got older, going to junior camp, intermediate camp, then junior high camp, and high school camp. Like, I loved going to summer camp. It was always a lot of fun to learn more about God and my faith and to meet other kids. So remember one year where I was probably in junior high, and we played a game at camp called Heaven or Hell. And the way the game was played was all the campers were given blindfolds. So you had to put the blindfold on to make sure you could not see. And so half of the counselors were angels and half were demons. And so you had to listen and determine, was the person talking to you trying to lead you to heaven or to lead you astray? And the goal was that you had to, without seeing, find your way just by listening to heaven. And you would know by when you got close, you could know if you're getting to the right place, because you could hear the other kids who'd made it to heaven. They'd be singing worship songs we learned that week at camp. And so you know I'm getting to the right place. But you had to figure out where to go just by listening. And it's hard to listen. Listening is a skill that, in our culture, we haven't done a good job cultivating. That instead, in our culture, we are very easily distracted. Just the other night, we watched a movie, a documentary on Netflix called The Social Dilemma. If you haven't seen it, it was eye-opening. It's about how these tech companies and social media platforms how their goal is to keep us distracted. That their goal is to keep us engaged, keep scrolling, keep swiping, keep on their platform, because they're selling us to advertisers. And it's all about how it seeks to keep us distracted. And this is an ongoing problem I have, that I've made the commitment on multiple occasions that my commitment is when I get home from being gone for the day and the kids are home and Joanna comes home, to plug my phone in and put it on the counter and leave it there. And I'm terrible at it. I always want to have my phone because there's a thought pops in my head, like, oh, I need to go look that up. Or, you know, I want to know about this news story. Or I want to see how many cases of COVID we had today in New Hampshire. Like, I always want to check these things because I'm so easily distracted. And the problem with distraction is when we're distracted, we're not listening. We're not paying attention to what's going on. We're not listening to each other or to God. It's been crazy. The last month, how many times I've been on Facebook and seen friends posting things and then seeing, like, you know, hundreds of comments where people are posting back and forth about whatever the issue is. And how all these comments, it seems like everyone's posting their thoughts but not listening to what someone else has posted. That there's no actual dialogue. It's just, this is what I think and you're dumb. Be quiet. There's no listening. That in our culture, we have not grown good at listening to each other or to God. And yet, here what we're going to see today in Daniel chapter 10 is that we all need to keep listening to the God who is in control. That we need to have our ears open to put aside the distractions so we can hear what God is trying to say to us. That we must listen to the God who is in control. Today we're in Daniel chapter 10. And Daniel chapter 10 begins the final climactic vision that God gives Daniel. At this point, Daniel is probably in his 90s. He's been in Babylon for over 70 years. His people have finally been able to go home, but Daniel is still in exile. He has not been able to return to his homeland. He's still in Babylon serving the kingdom of Persia. We're going to pick it up in Daniel chapter 10, starting in verse 1. This is in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia. A revelation was given to Daniel, who was called Belteshazzar. Its message was true, and it concerned a great war. The understanding of the message came to him in a vision. At that time, I, Daniel, mourned for 3 weeks. I ate no choice food, no meat or wine touched my lips, and I used no lotions at all until the 3 weeks were over. On the 24th day of the first month, as I was standing on the bank of the great river, the Tigris, I looked up, and there before me was a man dressed in linen, with a belt of fine gold from Uphaz around his waist. His body was like topaz, his face like lightning, his eyes like flaming torches, his arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and his voice like the sound of a multitude. I, Daniel, was the only one who saw the vision. Those who were with me did not see it, but such terror overwhelmed them, they fled and hid themselves. So I was left alone, gazing at this great vision. I had no strength left. My face turned deathly pale, and I was helpless. Then I heard him speaking, and as I listened to him, I fell into a deep sleep, my face to the ground. It says Daniel's given this vision of a great war. And this vision so terrifies and shakes Daniel that he fasts and prays for 3 weeks. He eats no food, no meat or wine, uses no lotions. For 3 weeks, he is so shaken and so rocked by what he sees that he fasts and he mourns for 3 weeks. And in response to this, God comes to strengthen Daniel. And Daniel has this vision of a man dressed in linen, with a belt of gold, a body like topaz, a face like lightning, eyes like torches, arms and legs like bronze, and a voice like the multitude. Who or what is this crazy, amazing figure? If we were to look, this picture Daniel's given is very similar to the picture we find in Revelation chapter 1, where the Apostle John sees Jesus. As he's got burnished bronze and a face that glows, and all these images are picked up in Revelation. So what Daniel is seeing, he's given a vision by God of the pre-incarnate Christ, that this is Jesus before he comes to be with us. He sees Christ, the Prince of Princes, the King of Kings, the Son of God. He sees the commander of God's host, this being that is the Son. Daniel sees the Son, and the Son begins speaking to Daniel, and Daniel listens. That when God speaks, Daniel listens. And the same needs to be true of us, that when God speaks, if we want to keep our faith in a world gone mad, we must listen when God speaks. And so God is going to speak to Daniel, and through that we will see how we can live as God's faithful people in a world gone mad. The first thing we see is that we must listen and do not fear. Listen and do not fear. Look at Daniel chapter 10, starting in verse 10. It says, "A hand touched me and set me trembling on my hands and knees. He said, 'Daniel, you who are highly esteemed, consider carefully the words I'm about to speak to you, and stand up, for I've now been sent to you.' And when he said this to me, I stood up trembling. Then he continued, 'Do not be afraid, Daniel. Since the first day that you set your mind to gain understanding and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come in response to them. But the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me 21 days. Then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, because I was detained there with the king of Persia. Now I have come to explain to you what will happen to your people in the future, for the vision concerns a time yet to come." Daniel's overwhelmed with the vision of the pre-incarnate Christ, the Son of God, and he collapses. And so it says the hand comes and touches him. Now I think what's happening in the story is that he sees the pre-incarnate Son of God, and then a messenger is sent by the Son to come strengthen Daniel. It says that he is touched by this divine being. And I think this divine being is not the same as the pre-incarnate Christ, but this is the angel or the divine being Gabriel being sent to strengthen Daniel, because so far in the book of Daniel, when a divine being has touched Daniel, it was Gabriel. So I think what's happening is he sees the pre-incarnate Son, and then the Son sends Gabriel to come speak and strengthen Daniel. So the divine being, Gabriel, comes and touches Daniel, and his message for Daniel is, do not be afraid. Do not fear. And so Daniel is calling out to us and reminding us that as God's people, we should not fear. And here's why. God's people should not fear because when God's people cry out to him, God listens and responds. You see that in the story? It says that Daniel has been fasting and praying for 21 days. He's crying out to God about this vision. God, this is too much. This is, I don't know what to do. And says, from the moment Daniel started praying, God sent Gabriel to answer his prayer. Now, the message was delayed. Gabriel says that he was battling for 21 days with this divine being known as the Prince of Persia, this fallen divine being who was opposing God and his people. And so, while it was delayed, the message was not denied. See, God, when his people cry out to him, God hears their message and he responds to his people. But we see this echoed in the New Testament where James writes and says, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. That do not fear, because if you are a follower of Jesus, your prayers are powerful, God hears them, and God responds. So when we pray, we're not just echoing words out that go out into the ether. We're praying to a God who hears us and who responds to us. So we don't have to live in fear of what's going on before us or around us. God hears and he responds. And while the message could be delayed because there are opposing evil forces, God's message will not be denied. God is bigger than any enemy force or any spiritual being who is opposed to God. God is bigger than them. God has already been victorious over them. So God is reminding us as his people, listen and do not fear. The next thing we see is that we should listen and speak honestly. Listen and speak honestly. Look at Daniel chapter 10, starting in verse 15. It says, "While he was saying this to me, I bowed my face toward the ground and was speechless. The one who looked like a man touched my lips, and I opened my mouth and began to speak. I said to the one standing before me, I am overcome with anguish because of the vision, my Lord, and I feel very weak. How can I, your servant, talk with you, my Lord? My strength is gone, and I can hardly breathe. Daniel is touched by this divine being, and he speaks honestly. He's like, God, I'm broken over this. I'm in anguish over this vision. I feel so weak and so helpless. My strength is gone. There's a tendency in our culture to not be honest. You may have noticed this. You may have friends like this on social media who everything they post is great. It's like, here, look at this recipe I just tried, how awesome it came out. Or here's the picture of my family at the apple orchard, and all the kids are smiling and together and looking at the camera, not off in the next apple row throwing apples at their brother. No idea where that may have happened. You see the job, you know, here's, I actually got a promotion at work, or look at my new car, like all you ever see are good things. But you don't see the reality of the tantrums the kid threw before the picture was taken, of the payment book that comes with that new car, of the hard work and the hours it took to work hard to earn that promotion, of the many attempts it took to get the recipe right, and how many times they got burned before the picture and the perfect one came out. Like, we don't see that on social media. That what we're called to be is to live honestly, to be authentic and be who we are, to let people see the real us. That we have a hard time being vulnerable and honest in our culture. And yet the Bible says that we're called to authenticity. That Paul is reminded by Christ in 2 Corinthians. Jesus says, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. That following Jesus is not easy. And there are days where God feels distant. There are days that reading the Bible is a chore. There are days that we sin and blow. There are days when things don't go the way they're supposed to, and we're stressed out and we're frustrated and we're done. And that's okay, because Christ's power is sufficient for our weakness. Daniel is collapsed to the ground because of weakness, and it says God touches him and strengthens him. And so we need to listen for God's voice, because he wants to strengthen us. And he wants us to be honest with him about what's going on and where we are in our lives, that he can speak his truth to us. And the next thing we see, that we need to listen and be at peace. Look at Daniel chapter 10, starting at verse 18. Listen and be at peace. Again, the one who looked like a man touched me and gave me strength. Do not be afraid, you who are highly esteemed, he said. Peace. Be strong now. Be strong. When he spoke to me, I was strengthened and said, speak, my Lord, since you've given me strength. So he said, do you know why I've come to you? Soon I will return to fight against the prince of Persia, and when I go, the prince of Greece will come. But first I will tell you what is written in the book of truth. No one supports me against them except Michael, your prince. In the first year of Darius the Mede, I took my stand to support and protect him. Just for a third time, this divine being, Gabriel, touches Daniel and speaks. And he says, do not fear, be at peace. Daniel's told, be strong. And there's a battle going on, but the divine being says, do not fear, be at peace. To be at peace means to have this sense of being whole or complete. It's a sense of fulfillment. It's not just a lack of strife or a lack of war, but peace is wholeness. It's fullness. It's having all the pieces put back together. God tells Daniel to be at peace because God says who Daniel is. That we can be at peace because God says who we are. Twice in this chapter, God calls Daniel highly esteemed. He says, you are highly esteemed. And the same thing is true for you.
God says you are highly esteemed. And you may say, well, I'm not Daniel. I wasn't a prophet. I didn't get visions. I wasn't some great leader in a kingdom. How could I be highly esteemed? God says you're highly esteemed because you are his child. And he loves you. And he wants you to know that you are valuable and precious in his sight. And maybe you say, well, yeah, but Daniel was a good person, and I've blown it. I've sinned. I've done bad things. Remember, last week, Daniel chapter 9, Daniel confesses. He says, I've blown it, God. I've fallen short of you. I've messed up. And we've all sinned. But just because we've sinned does not mean we are not highly esteemed. God calls you his own, that he endured the cross and took your sin because he delights in you. The Bible says that God delights over you with singing. I remember when I was a kid, my mom used to sing over me. Her two favorite songs were You Are My Sunshine and I Love You, A Bushel and a Peck, A Bushel and a Peck, and A Hug Around the Neck. All the time, mom would sing these songs. And as a kid, I was just like, whatever, mom, thanks. As a teenager, I'd be like, mom, be quiet. But now looking back, I understand what was happening. That as a parent who loved her child, the only way my mom knew to, well, not the only way, but one of the ways she knew to express her great love and delight in me was just to sing over me. And the Bible says that's what God does for you. That he delights over you with singing, that he's singing over you, that you are his sunshine, that he loves you more than you will know, that we can be at peace because God says you are his beloved child, that he delights over you, that God thinks you're awesome. And we can be at peace because God wins. The angel says, I'm going to go, Daniel, I'm leaving you, and I'm going to go battle these opposing spiritual forces, the prince of Persia and the prince of Greece, and Michael's going to help me. But we know the end of the story. He's already told Daniel, these kingdoms of Persia and Greece, they're going to fall. And God's kingdom will be the small rock that grows into a giant mountain that can never be defeated. The book of Revelation says that we have overcome, we've defeated the enemy through the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb. That God wins. That these opposing spiritual forces, they got nothing on God. They've already lost. And they know it. And so God wins. So we need to listen to what God is saying. Listen as he delights over you in singing. Listen as he says the victory has been secured at the cross. That we have won, so we can live at peace. We can allow God to take the pieces of our heart and our life and put them back together so they're whole. All the pieces are fitting together because God says he knows who you are. And he knows what the outcome will be. So keep listening. Listen as you pray. That prayer isn't just telling God what you want. It's listening to hear his voice, to hear him delight over you and speak his truth to you. Listen as you read scripture, that every page of this book God has given us is him speaking his truth to us if we would only listen. Listen as you talk to each other, that we're called to encourage and build one another up. And so listen to the words God may be saying to you through someone else. In the midst of a world gone mad where we are being tempted and seduced all the time to be distracted, to close our ears and not to listen, we need to put the distractions away and keep listening to the God who is in control. Listen to what God's saying about you. Listen to the victory God's already won. Keep listening. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you speak your truth to us. We thank you that you are with us, that you love us, that you'll be with us through all things. God, we thank you that you are singing over us now, that you're delighting over us with your words and your voice. God, we thank you for the ways you lead us. And so, God, we want to take a moment and to pray and lift up Garrett Hughes, who is heading off tomorrow to go to basic training for the Air Force. And so, God, we just pray for Garrett. We're so thankful for the way that you've led him. God, as he sought your will to know where to go, God, that he kept listening and has followed your leading. And so, God, we pray that you would go before him, that you would be his shield and his strength, that you would lead him through basic training and all he's going to go through. God, that you will provide for him not just brothers in arms, but brothers of you, Lord, brothers in Christ who can encourage him in his faith, that he can grow closer and closer to you. God, we're so thankful for their family. We pray your peace for Ginger and Rob and Aiden and Hunter and for Garrett, God, that you should be with them. God, they can feel the mighty hand of your comfort touching them, walking with them. And God, that they can be at peace as they listen to your voice. God, we love you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Church, we're going to respond now to what David said, and I would invite you to stand if you'd like. Or you can see, I'm
sacrifice of his son. Revelation chapter 12 says, "Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much, so as to shrink from death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He's filled with fury because he knows his time is short. Because now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God. Because the enemy has been defeated by the blood of the Lamb. Everyone can have an opportunity to remember what God has done for us. Not just forgiving our sins, which is huge, but the enemy has been defeated through the blood of Christ. That we can be at peace because God has already won. If you're here in the building, you can go ahead and open up to the wafer. If you're at home, you can grab your piece of bread or cracker, tortilla, whatever you have. Do you remember the body of Christ that was broken for us to give us victory? Let's take together. And we can open up the juice for your home. You grab your milk juice or water, whatever you have. So you remember the blood of Christ, the blood of the Lamb, secures our victory. Let's take it together. That we can be at peace because God has won. But there are still many people around us in our world who've not yet been given that victory. Who've not yet been brought close to God through the power of Christ because they don't know what God's done for them. And so every week we have a chance to give. And our giving is not just to give so we can feel good about ourselves or so we can buy things for the church. But that we give so that we can share God's victory with one more person. So we can see one more life changed and transformed by the amazing love of Jesus, like we've been changed. So there are a variety of ways that we can give. You can give of your time to serve and to show God's love in action to somebody else. You can give of your talents, that you can take what you're good at and use that to help the church as you reach out to others. You can give of your treasures, of what God's given to you. You can give back a portion of what God's given you to help support the ministry of the church so that we can continue to keep reaching out and keep finding more and more ways to love one more. There are a variety of ways you can give. If you want to give financially, you can place your offering in the giving box as you leave, or you can give online through our website or setting up online banking through your bank. Let's pray. God, we thank you. We thank you that you've given us the victory in Christ. But God, help us to be people who open our eyes and who listen to you to see that there are others all around us who've not yet learned of your great love, who've not yet received the victory you've already won for them in the cross. And so God, help us to give so that we can help one more person discover your amazing love. God, that we can help one more person discover and receive your victory. God, we thank you. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we close, again, I want to say thank you for joining us today, whether you're here with us in person or if you're joining us online. A few reminders, again, if this is your first time connecting with us, please fill out the online connect card so we can give some money away and we can stay in contact with you. Also, please join us on Wednesday for prayer time at 8. Please sign up to join us for Serve Saturday on October 24th so we can go and serve around our community. And also sign up for the online Bible studies coming up later this month. You can go to LondonderryChristianChurch.com and click events, and you can sign up for all the stuff that's happening at the church there. So again, thank you for joining us as we seek to keep listening to the God who is in control. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you're God overall, that you're in the same place you've always been, that you're seated on your throne. And God, may we continue to listen and to be at peace because you are sitting over us and because you've given us the victory already. So God, help us to keep listening to you and to find more and more ways to love one more. So in Jesus' name that we pray, amen. Have a great week and keep finding ways to love one more.
My grandpa, he was a talented tenor. So he's choir.
Feeling okay? I'm sore.
Really? Oh, we're in Salem.
We got him in Salem. Yeah, we got him in Salem. I almost came up and asked to borrow your jacket.
Were you cold?
Oh, it was chilly by the door.
Oh.
There's a third big one.